We're all here to go. We're all here to go. That's what we're all here for. Earth is going to be a space station, and we are here to go into space. That's what we're here for. Do I hear any questions about that? Proposition that we are here to go, that we're all here to go into space? What are you? And you. One of them here. Why did you come here? What did you expect to learn? What did you expect from me? What do you expect from me? Come on, tell me, I'm here. What do you expect from me? For John Dillinger, and hope he is still alive. Thanksgiving Day, November 28, 1986. Thanks for the wild turkey and the passenger pigeons, destined to be shit out through wholesome American guts. Thanks for a continent to despoil and poison. Thanks for Indians to provide a modicum of challenge and danger. Thanks for vast herds of bison to kill and skin, leaving the carcasses to rot. Thanks for bounties on wolves and coyotes. Thanks for the American dream to vulgarize and falsify until the bare lies shine through. Thanks for the KKK, for nigger-killing lawmen feeding their notches, for decent church-going women with their mean, pinched, bitter, evil faces. Thanks for killer queer for Christ stickers. Thanks for laboratory AIDS. Thanks for prohibition and the war against drugs. Thanks for a country where nobody is allowed to mind his own business. Thanks for a nation of finks. Yes, thanks for all the memories. All right, let's see your arms. You always were a headache and you always were a bore. Thanks for the last and greatest betrayal of the last and greatest of human dreams. See a hot shot hit, kid? I saw the gimp catch one in Philly. We rigged his room with a one-way whorehouse mirror and charged a Sosky to watch it. He never got the needle out of his arm. They don't if the shot is right. That's the way they find them. Dropper full of clotted blood hanging out of a blue arm. The look in his eyes when it hit. Kid, it was tasty. The meat cafe occupies one side of the plaza. A maze of kitchens, restaurants, sleeping cubicles, perilous iron balconies and basements opening into the underground baths. on stools covered in white satin, sit naked mugwumps, sucking translucent colored syrups through alabaster straws. Mugwumps have no liver and nourish themselves exclusively on sweets. Thin purple-blue lips cover a razor-sharp beak of black bone with which they frequently tear each other to shreds in fights over clients. These creatures secrete an addicting fluid from their erect penises, which prolongs life by slowing metabolism. Addicts of mugwump fluid are known as reptiles. A number of these flow over chairs with their flexible bones and black pink flesh. A fan of green cartilage covered with hollow erectile hairs, to which the reptiles absorb the fluid sprouts from behind each ear. The fans, which move from time to time, touched by invisible currents, serve also some form of communication known only to the reptiles. The sailor spotted his reptile. He drifted over and ordered a green syrup. The reptile had a little round disc mouth of brown gristle, expressionless green eyes almost covered by a thin membrane of eyelids. The sailor waited an hour before the creature picked up his presence. Any eggs for fats? He asked, his words stirring through the reptile's fan hairs. It took 2 hours for the reptile to raise 3 pink transparent fingers covered with black. It took 2 hours for the reptile to raise 3 pink transparent fingers covered with black fuzz. Several meat eaters lay in vomit, too weak to move. The black meat is like a tainted cheese, overpoweringly delicious and nauseating, so that the eaters eat and vomit and eat again until they fall exhausted. The painted youth slithered in and seized one of the great black claws, sending the sweet, rich smell curling through the cafe. Real tight, and put a splint on the limb to immobilize it if possible. Tie the guy down and then send for the helicopter. He'll get anywhere in Australia in a couple of hours. Well, they get him in there and decide whether to use anti-venom. See, anti-venom can be as life-threatening as the venom if there's any allergy. They have to test for allergy. That can kill within seconds. Anaphylactic shock. But now the amount of venom injected is under the control of the snake. Of the snake, yeah. Oh, hell yes. If you really get a snake mad, if you try to kill it or something, he will inject much more venom than he will in what is known as an evasive strike, when he just strikes and then tries to get away. Wait. Fuck around with any 9-foot typhons, particularly when they adopt a warning position and hiss explosively. Now, the only snakes that will attack without provocation are the black mamba in Africa, a very hysterical and very deadly snake. They get to be 10 feet long. The black mamba, the bushmaster in South America, that has a very weak venom, but a lot of it, and the king cobra. They will attack without. They've got. Not anywhere near one of the more potent venoms, but they got plenty of it. And it's potent enough. Potent enough. It's summer, spirit of early mists and showers. Ixtub, goddess of ropes and snares. Ixchel, the spider web that catches the dew of morning. Zui Kok, virgin fire, patroness of infants. Adziz, the master of cold. Kaku Pocket, who works in fire. Ixtub Doom, she who spits out precious stones. Ex-Jun Chan, the dangerous one. Apuk, the destroyer. Hiroshima, 1945, August 6. 16 minutes past 8 a.m. Who really gave that order?
Answer, control. The ugly American, the instrument of control.
Question. If control's control is absolute, why does control need to control?
Answer, control needs time.
Question, is control controlled by its need to control?
Answer, yes.
Why does control need humans, as you call them?
Wait, time, a landing field. Death needs time like a junkie needs junk.
And what does death need time for?
The answer is so simple. Death needs time for what it kills to grow in, for our poop's sake.
Death needs time for what it kills to grow in, for our poop's sweet sake, you stupid, vulgar, greedy, ugly American death sucker. Death needs time for what it kills to grow in, for our pook's sweet sake. You stupid, vulgar, greedy, ugly American death sucker. Like this. Brian Geisen had the all-purpose nuclear bedtime story. The all-purpose bedtime story, in fact. Some trillions of years ago, a sloppy, dirty giant flicked grease from his fingers. One of those gobs of grease is our universe on its way to the floor. Splat! Quite frankly, based on The Snows of Kilimanjaro by Ernest Hemingway. In fact, there are several quotations, and Where He Was Going is a quotation. Farm kitchen, blinds drawn, guns propped in corners. Plates and glasses have been shoved aside to make room for road maps. Four men lean over the maps. There is a basic sameness in the faces. Kerosene lamps cast a flickering light of death on cheekbones and lips, on the tired, alert eyes. Sure to have roadblocks here and here. Ishmael pours a generous portion of whiskey into a dirty glass. Couldn't we just hole up here? They don't rumble us moving out. They will close in for a house-to-house search. Makes sense. Let's try it here. And suddenly it occurred to him that he was going to die. Not sooner or later, he knew that, of course, they all did. But tonight, it came in a puff, the wind that makes a candle flicker, the sick, hollow fear hit him like a kick in the stomach. He doubled slightly forward, supporting himself on the back of a chair. It's always like this, he tells himself. The fear, and then a rush of courage and the clean, sweet feeling of being born. He read that somewhere in an old western. But the fear can go on and on until you can't stand it. It's going to break you, and that's when the fear breaks, you hope. Let's go, he croaks. He wonders if they're all as scared as he is. His gun seems clumsy and heavy in his hands. Alien, malignant. Sure they are, but they don't talk about it. Click of hammers and breeches. They're in the car now, shutting the door. He is sitting by the car door on the right side. The road is full of holes and water in the holes and deep ruts. Please God we don't get stuck, seeing themselves stumbling around in the woods with the bloodhounds closing in. Stop, douse the light. Chug, chug. Another car coming this way, closer. The light coming around a corner of the narrow road between heavy timber. Ishmael gets out slow, his feet like blocks of wood, and stands in the middle of the road, his hands up. The old car sputters to a stop. Old gray man behind the wheel. Ishmael walks over slow and shows the old man the wallet.
FBI.
Ishmael's lips are numb. This is no pawn shop badge. It's a perfect replica of the real thing with cards to go with it. Made up by a forger in Toronto. Cost $150. Flashed him out of some tight spots. The old man sits there with his face blank.
We're looking for some bank robbers. Hold up around here. You live here long?
40 years.
Must know the area.
He brings out a road map.
Now we've got roadblocks up here and here and here. Is there any other way they could get out?
Yep. Old wagon road cuts in right here. Bit rough, but they can make it. Comes out on County Road 52. Yep, they could get clean away.
If your information checks out, you'll be eligible for a reward of $500.
He hands the old man a card.
Just call the FBI office in Tulsa.
I'll do that. I surely will.
The old man drives on.
driver studies the map under the dashboard lights. Make it exactly 5 3/10 to the turnoff. Old man on the phone.
That's right. Posing as a G-man.
Ishmael remembers old Doc Benway saying, "You face death all the time, and for that time, you are immortal." The raccoon crosses the road, its eyes bright green in the headlights. Not hurrying, slipping along. And it came with a rush, a sudden evil-smelling emptiness. And the raccoon was slipping lightly along the edge of it. Get away to Mexico. I've been there. Only way to live. Got 5 G's and a money belt. Go a long way down there. The fear is back around his chest like a soft vice squeezing the air out. The gun heavy in his hands, he knows he couldn't lift it. All the strength is running out of him in waves of searing pain. They pull around a corner and light jabs into his eyes and his brain explodes in a white flash. And he is free, throwing the door open, jumping out in the air as the windshield explodes, glinting yellow shards, and Tom throws a hand in front of his face. Very light on his feet, the Tommy gun light in his hands like a dream gun. When a sincere young agent, religious son of a bitch too, leaps to his feet, rifle level. He hasn't made his dog meat yet, as they call it. Animals, his fellow agents tell him. That's what they are, animals. And don't you forget it. Get down for Christ's sakes, bellows the DS. And Ish stitches 3.45s across the boy's lean young chest an inch apart. He has the touch. It's an instrument, Machine Gun Kelly told him. Play it. He must have dozed off in the car. Another shootout dream. He knows they have been driving all night. Home safe now. Coming down into a valley. Warm wind and a smell of water. From here you climb 10,000 feet to the pass. Remembers Mexico City and his first reef of cigarette. Went crazy on it. Wonderful crazy, wandering down Nino Perdido, and everywhere he sees sugar skulls and fireworks, kids biting into the skulls. Dia de los Muertos, the boy tells him and smiles, showing white teeth and red gums. Very white, very red, and whiter and redder than life. And he thought, why not? I'd done it in the reform school. The boy has a gardenia behind his ear. He wears a white, spotless cotton shirt and pants to the ankle with sandals. He smells of vanilla. Ish used to drink it in reform school. The boy understands. He knows un lugar. They stop to watch 2 pinwheels spinning in opposite directions. He remembers the queasy, floating feeling he got watching it, like being in a fast elevator. The boy is smiling now and pointing to the black space between the pinwheels as they sputter out, and the blackness spreads wide as all the world, and then he knew that was where he was going. Ishmael died when they picked up the stretcher.
Thank you.
Los Alamos Ranch School, where they later made the atom bomb and couldn't wait to drop it on the Yellow Peril. The boys are sitting on logs and rocks eating some sort of food. There's a stream at the end of a slope. The counselor was a southerner with a politician's look about him. He told us stories by the campfire, culled from the racist garbage of the insidious sex rumor. East is evil, west is good. Suddenly a badger erupts among the boys. Don't know why he did it, just playful, friendly, and inexperienced. Like the Aztec Indians who brought fruit down to the Spanish and got their hands cut off. So the counselor rushes for his saddlebag and gets out his 1911 Colt 45 auto and starts blasting at the badger, missing it with every shot at 6 feet. Finally, he puts his gun 3 inches from the badger's side and shoots. This time, the badger rolls down the slope into the stream. I can see the stricken animal, the sad, shrinking face, rolling down the slope, bleeding, dying. You see an animal, you kill it, don't you? It might have bitten one of the boys. The badger just wanted to run up and play, and he gets shot with a .45 government issue. Contact that. Identify with that. Feel that and ask yourself whose life is worth more. The badger or this evil piece of white shit? As Brian Geisen said, man is a bad animal. Somewhere in the shadow of the Titanic disaster, still living by the inexplicable grace of God, slinks a cur in human shape. Today, the most despicable human being in all the world. In that grim midnight hour, already great in history, he found himself hemmed in by the band of heroes whose watchword and countersign rang out across the deep. Women and children first. What did he do? He scuttled to the stateroom deck, put on a woman's skirt, a woman's hat, and a woman's veil, and picking his crafty way back among the brave and chivalric men who guarded the rail of the doomed ship, he filched to seat in one of the lifeboats and saved his skin. His identity is not yet known, though it will, in good time. So foul an act as that will outright murder. This man still lives. Surely he was born and saved to set for men a new standard by which to measure infamy and shame. When I become death, death is the seed from which I grow. Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? therefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? Wherewithal shall we be clothed? But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. Lo, lo.
We have a new type of rule now. Not one-man rule, a rule of aristocracy or plutocracy, but a small groups elevated to positions of absolute power by random pressures and subject to political and economic factors that leave little room for decision. They are representatives of abstract forces who have reached power through surrender of self. The iron-willed dictator is a thing of the past. There will be no more Stalins, no more Hitlers. The rulers of this most insecure of all worlds are rulers by accident, inept, frightened pilots of controls of a vast machine they cannot understand, calling in experts to tell them which buttons to push. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness.
He keeps repeating himself.
Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven.
Nutty, nutty, nutty.
Ye can see it already, the jungle Hilton's, orchids bloom in the moonlight on the music, the bar with the orchids, and a tank against one wall full of piranha fish. The management throws in live goldfish and pieces of raw meat. It's quite an attraction. The motels, souvenir shops, and hamburger joints, drunken Indians, polluted rivers, the gritty bite of diesel fumes in front of the Manaus Opera House, tourists posing with a boa constrictor. Terrible scandal, a big pop star in a jealous rage fueled by cocaine grabbed his girlfriend's Yorkshire Terrier and threw it into the piranha tank. As the piranhas attacked the floundering dog, the hysterical starlet threw a heavy bronze ashtray which shattered the tank, spilling snapping fish and bloody water across the patrons as the disemboweled screaming dog dragged its intestines across the floor. Quite a scene it was, and of course there were plenty of cameras to freeze-dry this edifying spectacle for posterity and export. It's the little touches that make a future solid enough to be destroyed. Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say unto you,
that whosoever is angry with his brother without cause shall be in danger of the judgment.
Ye have heard?
It often says an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth.
But I say unto you that ye resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also. Ye have heard that it hath been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemies, but I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you.
Of course, this is absolute biological. This is biologic suicide, something madness. No, it's just ridiculous.
Love your enemy. It isn't easy to love an enemy. Since it goes against your most basic survival instinct. But it can be done and turned to an advantage. Let the love squirt out of you like a fire hose of molasses. Give him the kiss of life. Stick your tongue down his throat. Taste what he's been eating and bless his digestion. Ooze down into his intestines and help him along with his food. Let him know that you revere his rectum as part of an ineffable whole. Make him understand that you stand in naked awe of his genitals as part of the master plan. Life in all its rich variety, do not alter. Let your love enter in unto him and penetrate him with a divine lubricant. Makes KY Leland feel like sandpaper. It's the most mucilaginous, the slimiest, ooziest lubricant ever was or shall be. Amen.
Mariners sailing close to the shores of Tuscany heard a voice cry out from the hills, the trees, and the sky. The great god Pan is dead. Pan, god of panic, the sudden awareness that everything is alive and significant. The date was December 25, 1 A.D. But Pan lives on in the realm of imagination, in writing and painting and music. Look at Van Gogh's sunflowers writhing with pretentious life. Listen to the pipes of Pan in Jujuka. Now Pan is neutralized, framed in museums, entombed in books, relegated to folklore. But art is spilling out of its frames into subway graffiti. Will it stop there? Consider an apocalyptic statement. Nothing is true, everything is permitted. Hassan E. Saba, the old man of the mountain. Not to be interpreted as an invitation to all manner of unrestrained and destructive behavior, that would be a minor episode, which would run its course. Everything is permitted because nothing is true. It is all make-believe. Illusion, dream, art. When art leaves the frame,
and the written word leaves the page. Not merely the physical frame and page, but the frames and pages of assigned categories. A basic disruption of reality itself occurs. The literal realization of art. Success will write apocalypse across the sky. The artist aims for a miracle. The painter wills his pictures to move off the canvas with a separate life. Movement outside of the picture, and one rent in the fabric is all it takes for pandemonium to sluice through. Last act, the end. This is where we all came in. The final apocalypse is when every man sees what he sees, feels what he feels, hears what he hears. The creatures of all your dreams and nightmares are right here, right now, solid as they ever were or ever will be. Electric vitality of careening subways, faster, 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 stations flash by in a blur. Pan God of panic whips screaming crowds as millions of faces look up at the torn sky. Off the track, off the track. The planet is pulling loose from its moorings, careening into space. Filling cities and mountains and seas into the void. Spinning faster and faster, days and nights flash by like subway stations. Iron penis chimneys ejaculate blue sparks in a reek of ozone. Tunnels crunch down teeth of concrete and steel, flattening cars like beer cans. Graffiti through glass and steel like acid races across the sky in tornadoes of flaming colors. Cherry pickers with satin brushes big as a door inch through Wall Street, leaving a vast souvenir postcard of the Grand Canyon. Water trucks slosh out paint. Outlaw painters armed with paint pistols paint everything and everyone in reach. Survival artists, paint cans strapped to their backs, grenades at their belts, paint anything and anybody within range. Skyriders dogfight, collide and explode. Telephone poles dance electric jigs in swirling, crackling wire. Neon explosions and tornadoes flash through ruined cities. Volcanoes spew molten colors as the earth's crust buckles and splinters into jigsaw pieces. Household appliances revolt. Washing machines snatch clothes from the guests. Bellowing hoovers suck off makeup and wigs and false teeth. Electric toothbrushes leap into screaming mouths. The clothes dryers turn gardens into dust bowls. Garden jewels whiz through lawn parties impaling the guests who are hacked to fertilizer by industrious Japanese hatchets. Those and misshapen bulbous plants spring from their bones, covering golf courses, swimming pools, country clubs, and tasteful dwellings. At my back, faster and faster, I always hear, hurry up, energy ground down into, please, it's time closing. Sidewalks and streets by billions of feet and tires erupt from manholes and tunnels, break out with volcanic force. Let it come down, careening subways faster and faster, station blur by. Pan whips screaming crowds with flaming pipes.
Millions of faces look up at the torn sky. Off the track, off the track. Planet is pulling loose from its moorings, careening off into space, spilling cities and mountains and seas into the void, faster and faster. Skyscrapers scrape rents of blue and white paint in the sky. The rivers swirl with color. Nitrous ochres and reds eat through the bridges falling into the rivers, splashing colors across warehouses and piers.